Canada is committed to upholding human rights, freedom of expression, and the protection of journalists around the world. We have been actively looking, as I've said, at the contract that was signed by the previous government, which is a difficult contract, and we are looking at ways we can move forward in the way that Canadians expect us to.
So you see there, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, he's in a bit of a jam. He says there must be consequences for the killing of Saudi journalist Jamal Khashoggi, but Trudeau says cancelling a $15 billion deal to sell armoured military vehicles to Saudi Arabia could cost Canada billions of dollars in penalties, not to mention thousands of Canadian jobs. Still, Canada is supposed to be a defender of human rights, leading some to ask why there's such hesitation to cut ties with Saudi Arabia. Well, this might have something to do with it. The Saudi royals are the richest family on earth, much wealthier than the British monarchy, worth an estimated $1.4 trillion, and in charge of a quarter of the world's oil reserves. That buys you a lot of palaces, a lot of yachts, and more importantly, a lot of influence.
إذا نجحنا في الخمسات القادمة سوف تلتحق فينا دول أكثر وسوف تكون النهضة القادمة في العالم في 30 سنة القادمة في الشرق الأوسط إن شاء الله.
Barely 3 weeks after Khashoggi's killing, crowds were lapping up Prince Mohammed bin Salman's boasting about the kingdom's wealth at a conference in Riyadh. It's got a real name, but everyone calls it Davos in the Desert. After Khashoggi's killing, the Canadian government quietly chose not to send anyone to that conference, while the Americans were a lot louder about it. U.S. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin publicly backed out, as did Uber CEO and Ford's chairman. So, sure, some big names didn't go, but investors from the U.S., France, India, and China went, all of them wanting in on that Saudi money and Saudi oil. In 2017, the kingdom produced 12 million barrels of oil per day. That's almost 13% of the world's oil production. To put Saudi influence in perspective, all the kingdom would have to do is withhold as little as 3 million barrels a day, nothing for them really, to make the global oil price jump to $100 a barrel. Imagine that here. It would throw global markets into chaos. But where does all of that Saudi oil money go? In 2017, the kingdom spent more than $78 billion on arms, some coming from Canada and other Western countries. And it's not just money and arms that link us. We share strategic interests, too. Saudi Arabia is a vital ally in the Middle East, a partner against Iranian aggression and the continued spread of ISIS across the region. Peter Sutherland is a former Canadian ambassador to Saudi Arabia and Yemen and is a former board member of the Canada Arab Business Council. So let's get right to the heart of this. The killing of Jamal Khashoggi is one thing, but that is not the only accusation of massive human rights abuses in Saudi Arabia. You've also got the involvement of the Saudis in the war in Yemen. We've seen pictures recently of like these emaciated kids. There's civilians who are being slaughtered in Yemen. The Saudis are very much involved there. And yet Canada is selling these LAVs that may or may not end up there, but we know that these LAVs like this are used in Yemen. It's a war that's been condemned by the Canadian government. This looks pretty bad.
Absolutely right. I mean, there's no question that there have been moral atrocities, civil rights abuses, both inside the kingdom and outside of the kingdom, orchestrated or led by Saudi Arabia, for example, in Yemen. But in the kingdom itself, we know earlier experiences where media representatives have been imprisoned, some threatened with being beheaded. So it's an attempt on his part to crack down on all potential opposition or criticism of him as the leader.
And but meanwhile, Canada is selling these LAVs.
Correct.
To a country that is using LAVs like that in a war that this country's condemned.
Right.
It looks as if we're sort of not standing up to our human rights ideals.
But I think that's right. That's the conflict of the issue that our government has to address. Because on the one hand, it's an important sale. If you're selling a country weapons or equipment that can be used in the war, it's going to be used in war, wherever that war is, domestically or in Yemen in this case. And you have to be prepared for that, and you have to accept that. On the other hand...
And Canadians have to accept that?
Well, that's the decision we have to make. Do we have to accept it? But we also just have to decide if we don't accept it, if we back off and say that's the end of the contract, no more deliveries, cancel the contract, then there'll be consequences in terms of financial penalties and possibly, well, certainly make it more difficult to do business for any Canadian company in Saudi Arabia and for Canada to do business in some other countries, because they'll say, well, that looks a little bit like what they used to call, accuse the Americans of, light switch diplomacy. You know, sometimes the light's on and then 30 minutes later it's off. So countries would be a little circumspect about doing business with Canada. That's the threat. So you have to bear those kinds of consequences with the point you want to make to the Saudis, and that is, we don't accept this behavior.
Is that point being made?
It'd be made, but the trouble is, if we do it all by ourselves, you're not going to hear very much, because we're not, quite frankly, all that significant to the Saudis. If we do it in concert with other countries, and particularly if the United States takes a hardline position, that'll make a huge difference. But Canada acting with other G7 countries, for example, absent the United States, can still make a difference, and will make a bigger difference than if we're doing it all by ourselves.
Strategically, they're crucial as an ally. How much does that play into this? Like, what are the stakes?
Well, it's important because, just imagine, for example, if the Saudi monarchy fell, I mean, this is an extreme example, and was replaced by an Islamic Republic. Think of the consequences. The world's biggest oil exporter, controlled by Islamists. That would be a huge problem, and it would disrupt everything. It's the current situation in the Middle East dramatically. I mean, I don't think that's about to happen, but those are the kinds of things that you could envision if the monarchy were jeopardized to the extent that it could fall.
So we can never stand up? We can never say, no, that's just gone too far?
Sure we can, but there'll be consequences. In the short term, I mean, the oil situation is a global issue as opposed to a domestic one. For us, our imports from Saudi Arabia, they could come from somewhere else. It's not a big deal. But for the global economy, and more particularly, this is relevant to President Trump in the United States, he wants to keep oil prices down before the midterm elections. So he's going to lean on Saudi Arabia to keep the production up, not to curtail it. So that gives a little bit of leverage to Saudi Arabia, saying, well, you know, we better make sure that we stay good friends.
Mr. Sutherland, I'm going to ask you to stay with us for just a moment. But first, I want to take a closer look at the man at the center of any Saudi dealings or any Saudi debate, Prince Mohammed. He may be the face of the kingdom, but there are new rumblings he may never wear the crown.
Suggestions that Saudi Arabia's crown prince, Mohammed bin Salman, was directly involved in the death of Jamal Khashoggi are mounting. He's still on the throne, but it's a far cry from earlier this year when he was being hailed as a great reformer.
You are having radical ideas.
Women are now allowed to drive. You can go see American movies. Billionaires in Silicon Valley were happy to meet him. So was Jared Kushner. In fact, relations with the White House had rarely been friendlier. Remember, Trump's first visit as president wasn't to Ottawa, it was to Riyadh. But now that the Crown Prince is suspected of ordering the hit on Khashoggi, something the Saudis have denied, people have been changing their tune.
They had a very bad original concept. It was carried out poorly, and the cover-up was one of the worst in the history of cover-ups.
U.S. Senator Lindsey Graham, formerly a staunch supporter of Saudi Arabia, is now part of a chorus calling on Prince Mohammed to step down.
This guy's got to go. Saudi Arabia, if you're listening, there are a lot of good people you can choose, but MBS has tainted your country and tainted himself.
But how realistic is that? This is where it all gets very Game of Thrones. This is a royal family, after all. And recent history points to a lot of plotting and power plays in the quest for the throne. Prince Mohammed jumped the line of succession last year, replacing his cousin, who reports say was mysteriously detained. And a lot of other royals and some assorted billionaires were imprisoned too, with their assets seized, and what the Crown Prince sold as an anti-corruption campaign. Now, things are getting messy with the Khashoggi scandal. What will Prince Mohammed's father, the king, do? Some of the Crown Prince's closest advisors have been canned. Could the Crown Prince be next? Middle East expert Neil Quilliam told CNN recently that the international community has no ability to influence King Salman to say, drop your son. But former American ambassador to Saudi Arabia, Robert Jordan, told me an insurrection is possible and that the Crown Prince is watching his back.
I'm told that when he visited Houston recently at a large banquet, he had two food tasters with him, and perhaps for good reason.
In public, Prince Mohammed has been keeping up a powerful show. Here he is just this past week at his international investment conference dubbed Davos in the Desert. After Khashoggi, big-name Americans canceled plans to attend, still $50 billion worth of deals were struck. In another PR coup, the Crown Prince even managed to get Khashoggi's son to shake his hand on camera. So for now, the Crown Prince is holding on. But as suspicions grow around his possible direct involvement in Khashoggi's death, his fate remains to be seen.
Former Canadian ambassador to Saudi Arabia, Peter Sutherland, is back with me. So watching this, hearing the rumors and so on, I mean, you were an ambassador to the royal court. How likely do you think it is that that the Crown Prince will be replaced?
I think it's highly unlikely he'll be replaced in the short term. I think it's quite likely that there'll be behind-the-scenes efforts to sort of curb his zeal a little bit and to make sure that he's a little less impetuous in some of his ongoing activities. But, for example, just recently he's been appointed to head a committee to examine the intelligence services. So it doesn't suggest something like that he's being curbed too much initially. In the longer term, it could be that there could be a change. I mean, there have been changes forced from ruling kings way back, I think, in the 1960s. King Saud was removed by other members of the royal family because he was felt just not to be doing the job. So it's not unprecedented. But in this case, what you've got is a king who has devolved all of the authority, virtually all of the authority, economic, political, military, on his son. And for him to backtrack now, there's a lot of face involved. And moreover, the MBS, Mohammed bin Salman, has been very ruthless in eliminating a lot of the apparent or overt opposition. So I'm not sure what forces could come into play to force him away from that position.
If that were to happen, would it actually change anything if he were replaced by another prince?
It could change a lot, actually, because in this particular case, he has been made some pretty dramatic moves on the economy, this what they call Vision 2030, wean the Saudi Arabian economy off oil and make big changes, some social changes for the good, women driving, for example, opening cinemas, helping to appeal to the younger, to two-thirds of the population is under the age of 30. And all of these things are positive. The trouble is he's been very repressive both domestically and externally, and that's the issue, I think.
Thank you so much. It's all very interesting. Thank you, Peter.
My pleasure.